Hello, thank you for tuning in to Hope Church Rhondda's service today. My name is Owain. It's great to have you with us. So if you've never been into one of these, if you've ever watched anything or been into a service, here's what to expect. We're going to listen to a few songs to first, and then we're going to hear Ben preach on today's sermon. First off, what we're going to do is listen to a quick video about a program called Alpha. If you don't know what Alpha is basically something that people interested in faith go and do, a little course, and that answers some of their questions about God and Jesus and their faith in general. So yeah, we'll watch that now.
I went to the Alpha course so that I could learn more about God. And what I liked about the Alpha course was that I liked listening back to the opinions of other people, what they had to say about God.
When I first joined Alpha at the beginning of this year, I was so nervous to start, but after being there for like 5 minutes, I realised everybody's so nice and welcoming, and it's really chilled there, and it's really encouraging to hear other people's stories about God and about their journey.
I think people should definitely explore Christianity and do Alpha, because even though I was a Christian, I've done Alpha I think two or three times, and because I was already a Christian, it helped me so much in areas that I didn't know much of or didn't understand completely. So it was really good and encouraging for me in my faith, and also it was great seeing people come to Jesus through Alpha.
Yeah, so the Alpha course was a real eye-opener for me. I had loads of questions but didn't really know what to ask them. So the Alpha course really like covered the majority of the questions and broke them down and simplified them really well. So I found the Alpha course really, really helpful.
I took part in Alpha because I was new to Christianity. I found it really helpful because there was also others that are new to Christianity. It was really relaxed and I used to look forward to going every week.
It's been about a year and a half since my first ever Alpha session, and my life has just changed completely since. And because I was able to ask questions about doubts I had or things I thought were impossible, and I was able to ask people who genuinely understood the gospel for themselves rather than online or looking for other sources. And I feel like once you fully understand and ask questions about every single doubt you have, only then can you start to build a relationship with God if you decide you do want to give your life to Jesus.
If you're wondering what Christianity is all about, Alpha is the place to go. We don't just talk about Christianity, we explain it, we teach how we live it, and then also answer questions about everyday life and have discussions. The great thing is this isn't just about Christianity, but about everyday life, and we would love to share everyday life with you.
Okay, that was brilliant. So if you're interested in that, that starts tomorrow, Monday, 8 p.m. So if you're interested, please get in touch with us either via Facebook, Instagram, or just visit the website and we can give you details to get involved. All right, so now what we're going to do is listen to Lizzie. She's part of the church and she's going to talk to us about Open Doors. They are a charity that support persecuted Christians from across the world. So over to Lizzie.
Hi, everyone. I just want to spend a couple of minutes telling you a bit about Open Doors and praying for them. They are a charity which we as a church support. So if you give any money to the church, actually it doesn't always go to the church, it goes to a few different charities, and Open Doors is one of these. And it supports Christians around the world who are persecuted for their faith. So that means that they suffer in some way because they are Christians. And this could be in lots of different ways. It could be that they're not allowed to meet as a church. It could be that people are imprisoned or even killed because of their faith. So there are a lot of believers around the world who are very isolated, who live in fear because they're Christians. Now, Open Doors helps these Christians in lots of ways. Some of them are directly spiritual, so they might support leaders and train leaders. They might supply Bibles. And But they also give quite practical support as well to those who are persecuted. So for example, persecution might mean that the breadwinner of a family is imprisoned or even killed, so leaving their family really vulnerable. So Open Doors might provide food and other support to that family. And actually with COVID, problems, as you can imagine, have got even worse. And there are some situations where Christians have been excluded from support because they're Christians. So there's an area in Vietnam where people have been given food because of COVID, but the Christians have been told, oh, your God will provide, and haven't been given food. So just recently, Open Doors came to try and provide these Christians with food. And actually, as partway through the distribution, the authorities came in and stopped it and said, what are you doing? You can't do this. You can't give them food. And they had to then move to another town and do it in a very kind of covert way. So it was really, really tough for lots and lots of Christians out there. I'm just going to show a really, really short clip of in Vietnam, in this place, with just someone saying thank you for the provisions. As you can imagine, it's quite hard to get good films at the moment. So we'll just show you this one.
Xin hứa mọi người nghe ở trong tập tâm sự sẽ là những chủ ba số cho tập tây là tây ba tập tây tàu rất mạnh nào ở trong hiện tại là tây tàu dễ đưa sang ở khu vực 19 là ở trong và không có chuyển phòng không một trong sẽ được ở trong này.
I'm going to pray for Open Doors and for the people they support. So if you could pray along with me. And if you could just keep Open Doors in your prayers as well throughout the week, so that would be amazing. So let's pray. Lord, we thank you so much for Open Doors and the work they do. Thank you for everyone who works and volunteers for them, who often maybe even risk their lives to help Christians. And at this time particularly, we pray for more people. We pray that they would be able to get supplies and get help to the people who are most needy. And we bring to you all those Christians who serve you, who love you, who have given up so much, as you've given up so much for them. Lord, it's hard for us to imagine what it must be like living in fear of our lives for our faith. And we just thank you so much for the incredible example of these believers. And Lord, would you strengthen them? I pray they'd know your presence every single day. I pray your protection over them from their persecutors, but also from COVID. And I pray that provision would get to them and what they need and the support that they need. In your name we pray. Amen.
So we're about to go into a time of worship. But before we do that and we go to the band, I just want to read this to you guys. So it's from Romans 12:2. Therefore, I urge you, brothers and sisters, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. This is your true and proper worship. Do not conform to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you'll be able to test and approve what God's will is, his good, pleasing, and perfect will. So let's go over to the band.
Yeah.
Wow, that was brilliant. Thank you, band. So now we're going to listen to Ben.
Well, welcome and thanks again for joining us. My name's Ben. I'm one of the pastors here at Hope Church Rhondda. And we're going to spend some time in God's word together now. But before we do, let's just pray that God would speak to us through his word. Father, thank you for your word. Thank you for Jesus, the living word. And thank you for your Bible, your written word to us. And we pray now as we open it up together that your Holy Spirit would speak to us, that you'd help me to speak, and that you'd help us all to receive the message that you have for us today. In Jesus' name, amen. Excellent. I wonder whether you've ever thought, how can I be sure that I'm truly saved? Maybe you're with us and you're not yet a follower of Jesus. Maybe you've got some friends who are Christians, or maybe you're contemplating it for yourself and you're thinking, how will I ever know? How can I be sure that they are really now part of God's family and have received the gift of eternal life? Or how can I know for myself that I really can become part of God's family and receive that gift for myself? Today, we're continuing in the book of 1 Thessalonians. We're still in 1 Thessalonians chapter 2. And I'm hopeful that the passage we're going to look at is going to help us to answer this question. You remember that Paul and Silas and Timothy are writing, and they're writing this whole letter to give the Thessalonians confidence and assurance in their newfound faith. And at the start of chapter 2, Paul and Silas and Timothy, they write to defend and justify their ministry. They want to show that it's authentic by pointing to a whole bunch of characteristics in it that prove that it really was the real deal. They say, look, we're not trying to trick you. We're not lying to you. We're not out for our own gain. We're not trying to get your money. We're not trying to do this for the praise of men. We're the real deal. We've been loving you. We've shared our lives with you. We've loved you like mothers and fathers because we really do have a genuine gospel to proclaim. And so that's the first part of the chapter. But in verse 13, Paul changes his focus and he starts to show that not only did their ministry have authentic characteristics and so could be trusted and relied on, but it also produced very real results in the lives of these Thessalonian Christians. Imagine for a minute that downstairs in the basement of the church in the garage, I had a classic car, maybe a Jaguar E-Type. And I could take you downstairs and show you it. And I might point out the racing green paint job. I might point out the genuine leather seats. I might pop open the bonnet and show you the impressive engine inside. But to be really sure it was the real deal, you'd say to me, hey, Ben, it's lovely to see it, but why don't we jump inside and take it for a ride? You'd want to take it on a drive to see that it really could do what it said it could do, that it really could deliver the goods. And Paul here is making exactly the same argument to the Thessalonians. He's saying, look, I can point to you all the authentic characteristics of our ministry, but let me also show you the results that have been produced in your lives that show that your faith is real. And so because of that, this little section is a great section in helping us understand what evidence do we need to see in our own lives to be assured that we really have been truly converted. And so in light of that, let's read together from verse 13 to verse 15. We also thank God continually, because when we received the word of God, which you heard from us, you accepted it not as a human word, but as it actually is the word of God, which is indeed at work in you who believe. For you, brothers and sisters, became imitators of God's churches in Judea, which are in Christ Jesus. You suffered from your own people the same things those churches suffered from the Jews, who killed the Lord Jesus and the prophets and also drove us out. I want to draw your attention to three things in this scripture that Paul points to that he sees in the Thessalonians that should give them great assurance of their faith. And three things, therefore, that can give us great confidence in our faith if we see these three things in our lives too. And the first thing that Paul points to is the fact that the Thessalonians received the gospel as God's word and responded accordingly. You know, every single week we receive dozens of communications into our lives, don't we? Text messages, WhatsApp, social media, phone calls, emails, government briefings, news articles, all sorts of stuff is coming our way. Advertising. Lots and lots of communications. And every time one comes into our life from whatever medium, we have to ask subconsciously a number of questions about it. Is it true? Is the first one. Is the sender who they say they are? That's an important question, or we get spammed and scammed. Does it matter? Is it important? And finally, in light of those three things, how do I need to respond? Some of the communications that come in aren't true. Some aren't important. Some require a quick response. Some require a thoughtful response. Some even require a life-changing response. But one thing they all have in common is that they're all communications or messages from other people. And what Paul says here in 1 Corinthians 2, verse 13, he says, look, there's another communication. It's a communication, a message that comes from God, and it stands head and shoulders above every other message that you'll receive. It's more important, it's more authoritative, it's more true, and it requires a much bigger and greater and more urgent response than any other message you'll receive, because it's a message from God. You might be thinking, well, what is this word from God that Paul is talking about? And put simply, it's Jesus. John, at the start of his gospel, he says that the Word has became flesh and dwelt among us. That Jesus is the Word. He is the message. And in Acts chapter 17, you'll see that when Paul went to Thessalonica, that's exactly the message that he shared. It says this, as was his custom, Paul went into the synagogue, and on three Sabbath days he reasoned with them from the Scriptures, explaining and proving that the Messiah had to suffer and rise from the dead. This Jesus I am proclaiming to you is the Messiah, he said. Jesus is the Word of God. It's the truth that he came to earth and died on a cross in our place for our sin, so that we could be forgiven and made right with God. And then he rose again on the third day so that the death could be defeated and we could receive the gift of eternal life. Jesus is the rescuing King. That's the gospel. And Paul is saying that there are human words and then there is God's word to us. And that word is Jesus. He isn't just truth, he's the truth. He isn't just important, he's of first importance. He isn't just authoritative, he's the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And he demands a response, a life-altering response from our lives. And Paul is celebrating in 1 Corinthians 2, verse 13, that that's what he has seen in the lives of the Thessalonians. They've received Jesus as God's word to them. You know, in my house, we've been planning to move house for a couple of years and faced all sorts of problems. And one of the challenges that we faced because of that is that our current admin filing system has got filled up. And so now every time we get a letter through the door, whether it's a bill or council tax or a letter from the doctors or whatever it is, it just gets filed in one big pile that is stacking up in our study. And the only exception to that is if a specifically important letter comes through the door, we file it somewhere else because we know we need to respond. It actually goes and sits next to our toaster. And what Paul is saying is that the gospel is God's words to us. And therefore, it doesn't just get filed away like every other message and communication we've received in our lives. It should take special place in our lives. It should have an important and set apart place in our lives. Because to be a Christian is not just to acknowledge that there was a figure called Jesus who lived 2,000 years ago. It's not to just have a vague belief that Christianity could possibly be true. It's not about what school you went to. It's not about joining a social club or a religious order or a tradition. It's not even about acknowledging that Christianity is an interesting idea or moral code. To be a Christian is to receive the message of Jesus' death and resurrection, your forgiveness and the offer of eternal life through Jesus is to receive that message as of great importance and to respond to it by surrendering your whole life. And that is the first evidence that you have been truly converted. Here's the second one, is that Paul sees in the life of the Thessalonians that this gospel message has produced a visible change within them. You know, when we repent of our sins and we turn to Jesus in faith and we believe completely and fully in who he is and what he's done, a deep and important work happens inside our souls. You know, being a Christian is not just about a label or a badge of honor. It's not even just a box that we tick on a census. No, when we become Christians, truly become Christians and added into Jesus's family, there is a deep, deep work that happens inside us. I want to explain what happens in the heart when somebody gets converted. First thing is we hear this gospel message about Jesus. And when we get converted, we hear that message and the Holy Spirit works in us in such a way that it creates a conviction in our souls that we need to be saved. We realize that we're sinners, that we don't stack up against God's perfect standard. We can't meet it, and therefore we're going to be judged and we're in need of saving. And so the Holy Spirit produces that conviction in us. And then off the back of that, the Holy Spirit then gives us faith to believe completely that Jesus really can forgive us of our sins and make us right with God. And so because of that faith, we respond to this message by believing it and by repenting. That is turning away from all that is godless in our lives and all that doesn't honor God and turning to God completely in surrender. And as we do that, the Bible says that we are declared innocent and made right with God. That we use a word justification. And because we've been justified, God adds us into his family. He adopts us into his family. We are united with Christ in his death and in his resurrection. And through that, that means that we receive all of the privilege of being children like Christ is the Son of God. And we too, like Christ, can look forward to the inheritance that awaits us for all eternity. You see, when we become Christians, through the power of the Holy Spirit, there is a deep, deep change happening in the very depths of our soul. We are literally being made alive to God through his Spirit. And that, friends, is what it means to be a Christian. That's what it means to be born again. I want you to see that it's a deep inner work. Our very nature gets transformed, which is astounding, but it also begs the question, well, if it's such a deep thing, if it's going on in the depths of who we are, how can we be sure that we're saved, or how can we be sure that anybody else is saved? And the answer is this. This is the answer that Paul shows us in 1 Thessalonians 2, that when God makes us spiritually alive on the inside and comes to dwell in us, you simply cannot stay the same. Paul could see that an inner work had taken place in the Thessalonian Christians because it led to a dramatic change in the lives that they lived. Charles Spurgeon says it like this: another proof of the conquest of the soul for Christ will be found in a real change of life. If the man or woman does not live differently from what they did before, both at home and abroad, his repentance needs to be repented of, and his conversion is a fiction. You see, if you've been transformed by Jesus on the inside, then that is going to flow out into a changed life. And we see that, Paul sees it in the lives of the Thessalonians, which is why in chapter 1, verse 9, he identifies that they've changed from being those that worship idols to those that worship God. And those, and in verse 10, those that used to serve themselves but now serve God. And in chapter 4, those that used to love themselves but now love God and others. And also in chapter 4, verse 1, those that used to be self-pleasing have been transformed to being people who are now God-pleasing. These are the kind of things that happen when God transforms us on the inside. Jesus himself said that you can tell a tree by the fruit that it produces. And that's exactly what Paul is identifying here. He says, look, I can see that this gospel is indeed at work in you because of how you're now living. That's what happens to every true believer. You can't claim to have been deeply impacted by the gospel and made new in Christ if your affections and directions and patterns of living have not also been radically transformed. And so the first hallmark of a genuine conversion is receiving and responding to the gospel as the very word of God. The second hallmark is that it produces a visible change deep within us that flows out in a transformed life. And the third hallmark that Paul points us to in this chapter is that those who have been truly converted will willingly endure hardship in allegiance to their new king. Have a look what happens. Verse 14. He says this, "For you, brothers and sisters, became imitators of God's churches in Judea, which are in Christ Jesus. You suffered from your own people the same things those churches suffered from the Jews." Now, one of the key evidences that someone has been truly converted by Jesus is their willingness to face hardship in allegiance to their new king. Do you see what Paul is saying? He says, I'm going to celebrate your conversion, not just because you've received this message or because you've been transformed from within, but I can see that your faith is genuine because you're willing to deal with this suffering and this hardship that's coming on you from all sorts of angles because you love Jesus so much now. These new Christians were willing to face persecution because of the greater value of knowing God and because of the benefits of being in his kingdom. And this, of course, is the pattern of every single one of our lives. We endure hardship in order to receive benefit. We go to work and we slave away at our desks or in our jobs every day in order to receive the benefit of having a disposable income. You might be into baking. You slave away in the kitchen for hours in order to receive the benefit and the joy of a delicious cake. And you can deliver some to my house this week if you want to. You may be somebody who is doing night school or extra exams in your job in order to receive the benefit of a better career further down the line. We endure hardship because of the benefits that awaits us. And this, friends, is exactly the pattern of the Christian life. You know, we may not, as Christians in Tonopandy or Treorchy, have to deal with the challenge of persecution surrounding us. But there are very real hardships that come into our lives as a result of us surrendering our lives to Jesus. Because Jesus demands that we follow him with absolute allegiance in obedience to his commands. And that's not always easy. It often leads to us having to deny ourselves. And so some of the sacrifices that we might have to make when we come to Jesus are these. We might have to make relational sacrifices in that our friends might think we're crazy. Our family might speak to us and call us strange or try and heckle us or undermine our faith. No doubt there could be financial hardships because we're not going to cheat our tax returns anymore. We're going to start giving generously into God's kingdom and have less disposable income. There could be sexual sacrifices we have to make as we acknowledge that God's plan for our lives is purity outside of marriage and then marriage between a man and a woman. There might be lifestyle sacrifices that we have to make when all of a sudden our leisure life changes shape because of wanting to grow in Christ and be in church and be amongst his people. There might even be physical hardships as we battle to overcome that addiction to drugs or alcohol. There's all sorts of hardships and sacrifices that we have to make when we truly come to Christ to make him our King. And friends, we shouldn't be surprised. Jesus said this in Matthew chapter 16. If anyone wants to come after me, he must deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. For whoever wants to save his life will lose it, but whoever loses his life for my sake will find it. What will it profit a man if he gains the whole world and yet loses his soul? Do you see the pattern of the Christian life? It's the pattern of a cross, not a Christian. It's one of sacrifice and hardship and denial that proves our allegiance to our King. And you might be thinking, well, Ben, I'm not too sure that I can handle that. I don't think I can let go of this relationship or that money or this lifestyle choice that I'm making. And I would say to you, if that's the case, then you haven't truly grasped the preciousness, the beautifulness, the life-transforming power of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Because it's in losing our lives to those things that we find out, we find Christ, and we receive all the benefits of his kingdom and the gift of eternal life. And so, friends, how did Paul know that the Thessalonians were truly converted? Well, first of all, they received the gospel as God's message to them and responded accordingly. Secondly, there was evidence that their lives had been worked on deep inside their souls, and there was a visible change that came from that. And thirdly, they became willing to endure hardship and suffering and allegiance to their new King. What about you? What do we learn for ourselves from this scripture? Well, the first thing is this. It's possible to say that you're a Christian, but not to have received God's message as it truly needs to be received. To not have surrendered our lives in faith and repentance and not turned away from our old way of living and fully surrendered our lives to Christ. We don't get to define what it means to be a Christian and to be part of God's family forevermore. God gets to decide that. The person who starts coming to church or starts watching the live stream and says, I'm a Christian now, isn't really a Christian unless they've repented and believed and surrendered their life completely to Jesus. You might have discovered worship music and started listening to it, and you might be thinking, well, I'm a Christian now. You might have started reading the Bible and you think, I'm a Christian now. You might even said a prayer. We talk about the sinner's prayer. You might have said that prayer and you might think, well, I'm a Christian now. I'm on my way to heaven. It's not that any of these things are bad things, but as Paul has shown us, that what the gospel truly demands of us is that we repent of our sin, that we believe it wholeheartedly, that we give it the highest priority in our lives, that we allow the Holy Spirit to transform us deep within, that flows out with a life that's changed from being self-serving and self-pleasing and self-loving to being God-pleasing and God-loving and God-serving and God-worshipping. And as we do that, it's to say, Jesus means so much to us, I'm going to cling to him even though there's sacrifices and hardships and trials and challenges that are coming my way. And so for every single one of us this morning, there's a question, am I truly saved? I hope for many of us that this sermon will make us resound and say, yes, I really am. I can see that evidence in my life of making the message of Jesus the absolute priority and importance of my life. I can see how I've changed from being a self-worshipper to being God-worshipper and a self-pleaser to being a God-pleaser. I can identify the areas of things where I've had to lay down my life and pick up my cross to follow Jesus in allegiance to him. I can see all that. If that's you today, I want you to be celebrating with me. You can thank God continually because he has saved you. He's added you by his grace into his family. And if he's saved you, he will keep you in his family forevermore. But there might be some of us who are listening to this and you're thinking, actually, I'm not sure I'm truly saved. Maybe I've called myself a Christian, or maybe I've never said I'm a Christian. And today I'm realizing that this gospel is God's word to me, and it demands a great response. Maybe you look at your life and you're like, I thought I was a Christian, but I can't see that my life is radically different to the life I lived before. Or maybe you know that you've never allowed God to be the Lord of every area of your life. And you've said, well, God, I kind of want to accept you and surrender my life to you, but there's this thing I'm not willing to lay down. My finances, my relationship, my life with my family, my hobby, whatever it is that God is calling you to. And maybe right now in this moment, the Holy Spirit is saying, now is the moment to repent fully and believe fully and surrender fully to Jesus Christ. You can do that today. And the good news is that God holds out salvation to us. You can come to Jesus through faith, and he will transform you by his Holy Spirit from deep within your soul. You know, sometimes I don't think I've always done a very good job at presenting the gospel and the demands of the gospel fully to us as a church and fully to the community that we're serving. Following Christ, receiving Christ, means wholeheartedly turning from sin, giving up all that displeases him, renouncing the old way of life, and signing up to the way of the cross and making Christ your all in all. God forbid that in our evangelism as a church, we would invite people to become Christians, but dilute the gospel in such a way that by accepting our message, they remain outside of the kingdom of God and fail to receive the gift of eternal life. Let's pray. God, we thank you for this message. We thank you for those of us that are in Christ who have truly been transformed from the inside out and who have surrendered wholly and completely to you, receiving the message of Jesus as the word of God. I thank you that this message brings us great assurance and joy. I thank you, God, for the work that you've done in many of our hearts to transform us through your Holy Spirit and to transform the whole shape of our lives. We recognize your grace to us in that today. But God, for anybody who's listening, who measures their life up against those three evidences that Paul sees in the lives of the Thessalonians and comes out wanting, for anybody that says, I don't know whether I've truly got it, whether I've truly surrendered, truly grasped it, whether I've truly been transformed by the Spirit in my heart, I pray now, God, that you would grant people faith and lead them by your kindness to complete repentance. I pray, God, that we wouldn't be a church of people who cling to our old lives and therefore forfeit this salvation or forfeit the assurance of salvation, but we would be people willing to die to our old way of life, to put our sin to death once and for all, to leave our idols behind, just like the Thessalonians, and come to you completely in surrender, giving all our allegiance to you. And so, God, would this be a day of salvation? Would this be a day where those who don't yet know you, or maybe have accepted a form of Christianity that we don't see in the scriptures, I pray that today would be the day of salvation for them. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thanks, Ben. That was great. So we're now going to go into another worship song. And this one's a bit more about the fundamentals of what we believe in. So it's a great opportunity for you to reflect on the words of this song and whether that's really producing the change inside you and in your heart that God really wants to see. So I'm just going to use this second to say a quick prayer. Lord, thank you for your word. Thank you, Lord, for your messages that you've given us today. I pray that through the song that we're about to hear, that people are able to open up their hearts and ears and eyes to you, Lord, and that they can see some magnificent changes in their world and in their life because you will it and you want it. In Jesus Christ's name, amen. Over to the band.
Sog bywyd pur yn marw, marw I brynu'n bywyd ni.
Pwy all leidio'ch ofio amdano, pwy all leidio'ch ddeith I ddod. Dyma gariad nad amlanno, tra
is love vast as the ocean,
loving kindness as the flood. Seek thy kingdom only.